Simon & Schuster Audio presents No Man's Nightingale, an Inspector Wexford novel by Ruth Rendell. Read by Nigel Anthony.
Chapter 1. Maxine was proud of having three jobs. These days, more and more people had none. She had no sympathy for them, but congratulated herself on her own initiative. Two mornings a week she cleaned for Mrs. Wexford, two mornings for Mrs. Crocker, afternoons for two other Kingsmarkham women, did gardening and cleaned cars for Mr. Wexford and Dr. Crocker, and babysat every evening where she was wanted for those young enough to need a babysitter. Cleaning she did for the women, and gardening and car washing for the men, because she had never believed in any of that feminism or equality stuff. It was a well-known fact that men didn't notice whether a house was clean or not, and normal women weren't interested in cars or lawns. Maxine charged maximum rates for babysitting, except for her son and his partner. She took care of her granddaughter for free. As for the others, those who had kids must expect to pay for them. She had four, and she knew. She was a good worker, reliable, punctual, and reasonably honest, and the only condition she made was payment in cash. Wexford, who after all had until recently been a policeman, demurred at that, but eventually gave in like the tax inspector up the road did. After all, at least a dozen other households would have paid almost anything to secure Maxine's services. She had one drawback. She talked. She talked, not just while she was having a break for a cup of tea, or while she was getting out, or putting the tools away, but all the time she was working, and to whoever happened to be in the room. The work got done, and very efficiently, while the words poured out on a steady monotone. That day she began on a story of how her son Jason, now manager of the Kingsmarkham Questo supermarket, had dealt with a man complaining about one of his checkout girls. The woman had apparently called him elderly, but Jason had handled it brilliantly, pacifying the man and sending him home in a supervisor's car.
"Now my Jason used to be a right tearaway,"
Maxine went on, and not for the first time.
"Not in one of them gangs, I'm not saying that, and he never got no asbos, but a bit of shoplifting. It was like it came natural to him, and out all night and underage drinking, well, binge drinking, like they call it. As for the smack and, what do they call them, description drugs, my Mr. Wexford can't hear me, hope he's out of earshot. All that he went in for, and now since him and Nicky had a kiddie, he's a changed character. The perfect dad. I still can't believe it."
She applied impregnated wadding to the silver with renewed vigour, then a duster, then the wadding once more.
"She's over a year old now, is Isabella is, but when she was a neonatal it was never Nicky got up to her in the night, she never had to. No, it was my Jason had her out of her cot before the first peep was out of her. Walked her up and down, cooing at her like I've never heard a bloke go on so. Mind you, that Nicky never showed no gratitude. I call it unnatural, a mum with a new baby sleeping the night through, and I've told her so."
Even Maxine sometimes had to pause to draw breath. Dora Wexford seized her opportunity, said she had to go out, and Maxine's money was in an envelope on the hall table. The resumed monologue pursued her as she ran out to the conservatory to tell her husband she'd be back in an hour or so. Wexford was sitting in a cane armchair in autumn sunshine, doing what many a man or woman plans to do on retirement, but few put into practice, reading The Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire. He had embarked on it expecting to find it heavy going, but instead becoming fast enraptured and enjoying every word. Reaching the end of the first volume, he was happy to anticipate five more, and told Dora she'd picked her moment to desert him.
"It's your turn," she whispered. "I didn't know we had a schedule."
"You know now. Here starts your tour of duty."
As Dora left, Maxine swooped, pushing the vacuum cleaner, and continuing to hold on to it while she peered over his shoulder.
"I've got a guide to Rome there, I see. Going there on your holidays, are you? Me and my sister took in Rome on our 10 Italian cities tour. Oh, it was lovely. But hot, you wouldn't believe. I said to my Jason, you and Nicky want to go there on your honeymoon when you get around to tying the knot. There's no untying. Only these days, there is, of course, no point in getting married, if you ask me. I never did, and I'm not ashamed of it.
She started up the vacuum cleaner, but continued to talk.
It's Nicky as wants it. One of them big white weddings, like they all want these days, costs thousands. But she's a big spender. Good job my Jason's in work, like so many's not.
The voice became a buzz under the vacuum's roar. She raised it.
I don't reckon my Jason would go away on a honeymoon or anything else come to that without Isabella. He can't bear that kid out of his sight for his 8 hours work, let alone a week. Talk about worshipping the ground she treads on, only she don't tread yet, crawls more like.
A pause to change the tool on the end of the vacuum cleaner hose, then...
You'll know about that poor lady vicar getting herself killed and me finding the body. It was all over the papers and on the telly. I reckon you take an interest, though you're not doing the work no more. I had a cleaning job there with her, up till a couple of weeks back, but there was things we never saw eye to eye on, not to mention her not wanting to pay cash. Wanting to do it online, if you please, and I couldn't be doing with that. She always left the back door open, and I popped in to collect the money she owed me, and it gave me a terrible turn. No blood, of course, not with strangling, but still a shock. Don't bear thinking of, does it? Still, I reckon you had to think of things like that, it being your job. You must be relieved getting all that over with.
Standing up, clutching his book, I'm going to have a bath, Wexford shouted above the vacuum's roar. Maxine was startled from her monologue.
It's 10:30.
A very good time to have a bath,
said Wexford, making for the stairs, reading as he went the last lines of Volume 1, describing another murder, that of Julius Caesar. During the greatest part of a year, the orb of the sun appeared pale and without splendour. This season of obscurity, which cannot surely be compared with the preternatural darkness of the Passion, had been already celebrated by most of the poets and historians of that memorable age. His mobile was ringing. Detective Superintendent Burden, known to the phone contacts list as Mike. I'm off to have a look at St. Peter's Vicarage, taking Lynn with me, and I thought you might like to come too. Wexford had already had a shower that day. A bath at 10:30 a.m. wasn't needful, only seized upon as a refuge from Maxine.
I'd love to.
He tried to keep the enthusiasm out of his voice. Tried and failed. Sounding surprised, Burden said, Well, don't get excited. It's no big deal.
It is for me.
He closed the bathroom door. Probably Maxine wouldn't open it, but would perhaps conclude that he was having an exceptionally long bath. The vacuum cleaner still roaring, he escaped out of the front door, closing it after him by an almost silent turning of the key of the lock. Taking an interested member of the public, that after all was what he was, on a call or calls that were part of a criminal investigation, was something Wexford had seldom done, while he was himself an investigating officer. And his accompanying Superintendent Ede of the Met on the vault inquiries was a different matter as he, though unpaid, had had a kind of job as Ede's aide. This visit, this opportune escape from Maxine, was undergone, he knew, because once senior and junior officers, over the years they'd become friends. Burden knew none better how much Wexford would wish to be involved in solving the mystery of who had killed the Reverend Sarah Hussein. All Wexford knew of the death, apart from what Maxine had mentioned that morning, was what he had read in yesterday's Guardian and seen on the day before yesterday's regional television news, and seen, of course, when passing the vicarage. He could have pursued more online, but he had cringed from the colourful headlines. Sarah Hussein was far from being the only woman ordained priest of the Church of England, but perhaps she was the only one to have been born in the United Kingdom of a white Irish woman and an Indian immigrant. All this had been in the newspapers, along with some limited biographical details, including information about her conversion to Christianity. There had been a photograph, too, of a gaunt woman with an aquiline nose in an academic cap and gown, olive-skinned, with large, deep-set black eyes, and what hair that showed, a glossy jet black. She had been 48 when she died, and a single mother. Her origins, her looks, striking but not handsome, her age, her single parenthood, and above all that conversion, made him think that her life cannot have been easy. He would have liked to know more, and no doubt he soon would. At the moment, he wasn't even sure of where the murder had taken place, only that it was inside the vicarage. It wasn't a house he had ever been in, though Dora had. He was due to meet Mike and...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.